this panel discussion. I think the great thing today is that we've got some of the top built-to-rent providers operating currently in the country, but each with a different platform. And I think today what I wanted to do is get these people together just to kind of actually see where the similarities lie, where the differences occur, and the reasons why that. So if you could introduce yourself and just give us a brief summary of your approach to interior design and how it affects your particular projects and reasons why. So I'll really answer
that. Is that for me, is it?
Yeah, you might as well go over that, that way.
Thanks. Alison Mullins, Managing Director of Vertus. For those unaware, Vertus is the built to rent operator for Canary Wharf Group. So our strategy for interior design is we want to get as early as possible to understand what the interior design of all our buildings look like. The key for us is making sure that we've got plenty of time for procurement of any items that are going into that interior, but also looking forward to the future as much as possible to future-proof the design of all these buildings, the interior design of the buildings. The interiors for us has to speak to the exterior of the building, so it's based on our estate in Canary Wharf. And for us, we've looked at it very much in our first phase, our first three buildings, and we went as individual as possible. I think what we've learned is that individuality is brilliant at the outset from a marketing point of view, but actually standardisation is probably some of the route we're going to go down more, because quite simply when you've got five different colourways and three different furniture packs going up through a 58-storey tower, it causes a lot of problems operationally when people move out, when somebody stains a mattress, when someone breaks a chair. You know, you've got to go and procure those individual items again. But on amenity, amenity is our big focus. We think that's our selling point, therefore, it's a big focus for us, the interior design of that amenity space.
Thanks,
Alison. Can people hear me through the panel?
Ah, they can. Well,
hi, I'm Mark Woodrow. I'm co-managing director of Pappage Living. So we're an investor, developer and operator in the BTR space across the UK. We operate three main areas. So we've now got over 3,000 homes in our pipeline in multifamily. There's American Parks, or we all call town and city centres. We've got another 1,000 homes in our single family strategy, which is a joint venture with Aviva Investors, who are investing $700 million through that strategy to be levered. And we also have an advisory business that advises currently probably the most highest profile is Hanson on some of its schemes in terms of repositioning its retail portfolio. Our approach to amenity, the amenity is, you know, like the first bite of the apple is with the eye, the amenity is the first bite of the building, isn't it? It's the first place you go into, it's absolutely fundamental to the scheme, it's absolutely fundamental to the sales walk and the people's enjoyability of the product as they live in it. So, and I'll go on to talk about our approach a bit more later.
I'm
Ilaria
Ferrari, I work for Grid Architects. I'm an interior designer and an architect. Grid Architect has done a lot of built-to-rent schemes. We've been working on different schemes where we've done the architecture, we've done the interior design, and in some cases we've done both of them. We find working on both the architecture and interior design very helpful. As Alison was saying, the interior and exteriors work together and they're linked together, they're linked to the context. And we like working on buildings where we do the full package. We find a very successful result. We do work on interiors, and I do have a quite strong idea about the interiors being need to be unique, need to be different from the rest, because there's so many different schemes around. You want to be different, you want to be natives, you want people to choose a specific place because they love the look and the feel and how they feel in the space. So I think we can explore a bit more of this. So we just do interior design for built to rent, for amenities, apartments, and how we can standardize all the apartments.
Rochelle Hamilton, Senior Asset Manager at AXA-RIM, Board Director for Dolphin Square. So I'm currently leading the, what we hope to be, the 7-year restoration program of Dolphin Square, which is 434 apartments in Quivenco. Built in the 30s, my background for the last 10 years has been repositioning legacy estates, often run down estates from the 70s or 60s. So the approach to interior design is slightly different in that you're constrained by what you inherit. And you don't have that lovely stack of perfect apartments.
developer and an operator, and we've got just over 3,000 apartments currently leased and occupied. And we have another 400, which we're going to start mobilising at the end of this week. We've got three, well, because we're all based in one place, first of all, as you can imagine, just like for Alistair, that's a challenge and a benefit to us. So we approach it in three main ways. Firstly, we focus really, really hard on our interior design story, development to development. So how do we differentiate? We've got mainstream product, but we've also been quite bold and adventurous in some of our schemes. And that ultimately gives our customer choice, because one of our biggest challenges is naturally we are our biggest competition in our own site. But that's backed up by a really detailed design brief, which has got really detailed, you'll know it well, Lawrence. It's got all the components, the functionality, all the practicality aspects, that leaves creative freedom. And then lastly, we've leveraged partnerships across the estate. Tico, I can see, are sat in the audience, and Samsung and people like John Lewis, where we leverage the partnership and scale without hindering creativity. So we bring those three things together to form our approach.
Thank you all for your introductions. I think what I wanted to focus on first of all is kind of where we are in the build-to-rent process. So we've actually all experienced kind of first-generation build-to-rent, which is actually in many cases a private for sale product that we've had to work on to get to it to be working for build-to-rent. But now more and more commonly we're working on purpose built. What are the key lessons learned from an interior design point of view that you've experienced, that you're bringing in, lessons learned, and what do you think is going to change in the future? Alistair again.
I think first and foremost, occasionally what architects draw on the plans doesn't work in reality. Sorry to say that. But you get in there, you get into that space, it doesn't quite work in the same way. I think for me it's balance between efficiency and aesthetics. Sometimes it's an efficiency in the way a space is laid out and the way you're going to use the furniture versus aesthetics. Now people actually have to live in these apartments, and we might make our show units look absolutely amazing, but quite honestly a resident gets in there and starts dragging the sofa one side to the other and put the dining room table in the corner because they're never going to use it. So I think for us, what we've definitely learned is you've got to have that balance, especially in the show units, of what is practical and what is going to be actually aesthetically pleasing on the eye. But I think you've got to get that design of each apartment type right. I mean, much like everybody, I'm sure, try and trim down our number of unit types to as minimal as possible to make our lives as easy as possible, both in construction, in operations and leasing. And you know, once you need to try and create that perfect apartment that has perfect space in the living room, perfect amount of space in the bedroom, good circulation space around the bed and things like that. And I think for us that's the main learning to focus is trying to get those unit types right from day one. It's very hard sometimes looking at it on a plan. So in a lot of our cases we will build out units within our sheds so we can actually test those apartments, what those spaces feel like as well.
Well, to build on that, we spend a lot of time around the furniture and the space planning of the furniture. Linked to that, we've provided our architects with real sizes of furniture to actually be placing on the plans so that at the early stages, we know that we're going to have choice when we hit the procurement and interior design stage of the furniture. And we're not going to be limited to, say, double beds because the market's moved on, it's king-size beds now, et cetera, et cetera. So the furniture piece is one. The other one is social spaces, and you referenced it well, Lawrence. We purpose-built our first two developments for BTR was the repurposing of leasehold product. So we had to retrofit those social spaces, which come with their own challenges. They're street facing, there's no management space nearby, they're not near the concierge. We've then gone to the other extreme and we've got some absolutely stunning developments, really adventurous, but with tons and tons of social spaces in different locations, which then brings a different management challenge. So what we're finding is hitting that sort of sweet spot between something adventurous to be able to sell, but that we can manage really well. It isn't too laborious on the operating budgets to manage.
Can I get boring one?
Yeah, go on.
Durability is probably key to us. If you want to try and get your OpEx down.
In terms of what you've learned.
Yeah.
sorry, Mark, to bring Laura in though, because what we're seeing is more and more standardisation. We completely understand that, the procurement issue that Alistair raised. So, Laura, how do you manage that as an interior designer to get that differentiation in, and also to represent each of the brands that you're working with?
I think the first thing is probably having a very clear brief from the client to know exactly how the space is going to be used, which kind of customer or client are going to use the space, so customize it. So the look and feel make each space to feel unique. That's not standardizable. You know, you can't change that. Every space will have to look special in talking about communal areas, okay? But I think what we can standardize the materials that we use, because we can use durable materials. We know what the durable materials are. We know what is not going to get ruined, scratched, or damaged easily, and it's going to be easy to replace. We know how we can do certain details because they're more robust, they're more durable. So we can standardize the flat, because when we work out what's the best flat and the best balance between the living room space that we want and the bedroom, we know the size, we know what we want, we know the storage that people are looking for. So I think those are all the things that can be standardized. But the finishes, the look, and as Jenny said, we can leave it open to the architect's interior design to imagine the space and create something new all the time. I don't think that can be standardized.
I think those lessons learned come from experiences, don't they? So before we set up Package Living 5 years ago, I had an experience. I used to run the Van der Granger, obviously a long-term investor and an early mover in the BTR space. Back in 2011, we talked about first-generation schemes. We bought a scheme from Bouygues in Barking, 100 homes. It was a for-sale scheme, really, and we retrofitted the labour amenity in there and did all that kind of stuff. And I remember going back, and it's great to go back to things you've delivered and you get that little tear in your eyes and walk up and think, bloody hell, it took a lot of effort to get it to this point. I remember walking into that amenity space at ground floor, and there was a homework club going on with kind of 12 children. And I hadn't, up to that point, really thought about this building properly being used by families. I always thought it would be the archetype of 20-something, 30-something that was going to live there, and that was probably what our marketing told us was going to happen, but it wasn't actually what happened in reality. So it's really important, and from that we learned about, you know, those spaces need to be really flexible, they need to be able to be used by a much wider demographic than the people that we might visualise and the brands that we might visualise at the time when we're thinking about the space. So we go, and I ask my development managers now to go back to those places. We just delivered a scheme at Milton Keynes called the Almere in conjunction with UNESCO, and I ask them to go back there. Every time I go back there, I learn something else about how those people use their next space. Those things that you've thought a lot about, do they care about those? Do they not care about those? The places where you spent a lot of money, actually, we missed that. We spent money there and lost value because that's not really adding value. It would have been better to spend it there, whatever those things might be.
Just on top of that, I think it's quite simple for my mind, is what are people using their apartment for? Mm. That initial wow factor is really important in marketing, but actually it's the worktop space in the kitchen, it's light in the kitchen so they don't chop their finger off, it's like dishwasher compared to the bin and the sink, it's the little things, heated mirror in the bathroom for me is a non-negotiable, you've got to have one. You can't get out of the shower in the morning and not be able to see the mirror. There is no extractor fan in the market. In these internalised bathrooms, I can get rid of that steam. If you find me one, anybody, please let me know, because it's not possible. So that's a non-negotiable. A good heated towel rail, so your towel is actually dry when you come back to it in the evening, and you're going to go to the gym or whatever. You know, these are actually, you know, comfy bed, comfy sofa, a television alert, internet's on interior, but that's what people want. Actually, it could look absolutely amazing, but they're not comfortable on the sofa. They're not
going to stay. But aren't those given that in some respect, though? You know, they should be given of a good space.
Absolutely, but, you know, door crashes. You come in, and as soon as you come in, the door smashes the front door. Your bedroom door smashes the back of the wardrobe. You know, all these little things are things that frustrate people, so they left their wardrobe door open, and then they've opened their bedroom door and smashed into it, and they think they might get charged with a deposit. So these are, to me, they're little, you're right, they should be a given. But I think still now we're still facing those issues in designing departments we're designing today, because you're sometimes limited by the space we're creating for these departments. So 500 square foot one bit, it's hard to make that work.
But to be devil's advocate, is there a danger that if we're standardising every provider providing the most optimum, get the door swing right, light positions, everything? You know, I think about when I used to rent and a about kind of a place character and you know, a bit of kind of distinctiveness. Isn't there a danger that we're kind of sterilising aspects of interiors, or do you think there's still enough freedom? Maybe Larry's going to want to start with this one, to keep that free. I mean, Roshan with Dolphin Square, in some ways, he won't thank me for this, but he's fortunate that he has got such a variety. So there is that kind of, you know, you don't like that one bedroom layout, you can go down the corridor and there's a different one. So I just want to kind of get everyone's thoughts on that, because in a way it's becoming like a car industry. You know, you get your chassis, you get your car, you change the kind of the trims and everything like that. And then Tesla kind of came in and kind of shook it all up a little bit. So sorry for the long explanation, but I want to get everyone's thoughts about what you think about that standardisation.
Especially when you've got a very big scheme like Dolphin Square, where you've got 1,230 apartments, if there is no variation, if you only found 3 1 beds, they are perfect. Yes, they are perfect, but is everybody going to really want to want, you know, these 3 1 bedroom layouts that they're perfect? Obviously, in Dolphin Square, you've got
only four different.
I don't even want to think about it, how many types you've got, but you know, you've got so many variations that will suit different people with different needs, because in reality we're all different, we all have different needs, you know. People will have different hobbies, different things they like to do, a bigger wardrobe, less, say, you know, more sport equipment to store, or, you know, different things that we want to have in our flat. So you have to give a little bit of flexibility, don't you?
But I suppose you only need to do that if you see that there's a market for it.
Yeah, I think when we were going for the design of Dolphin Square, we were very conscious that if you've got, let's say, 600 bomb beds, got a commodity, that's how you have the market at all. I don't think in that particular location, which you talk about many one best, so you've got to have a good variety of cleaning, you know, walking orders where we can go with desk spaces. So there are different flats for people who have different needs to prioritize different factors into their flats.
It is partly a function of size, isn't it? Because mm-hmm. So if you're delivering a 200-250 home scheme, then there aren't as many. Maybe you're not thinking about that as much. Whereas if you're delivering a 600 home scheme in Southampton, which is two different buildings, and you want to give each of them a character, so you want them to be a different type, and because it's less, you know, if you try and dictate that too much with one building, then you're going to turn off some of the market. So and the nuances that you talk about, and the character you talk about, I want to see it. The PRS sector as a broad, right, that's huge, isn't
yeah.
it? So you still got to get that. But if you want to live in a new build, then you come to these buildings.
Well, that's the benefit, actually, of you know, the diverse portfolio, the contained portfolios. I always, you know, hear Colin talking about your schemes and the kind of the letting experience, and the idea is once you get them to Wembley, they might not like the interior of one building, but you can just take them 100 metres to another one, they might like the interior, and that's the benefit when you've got that quantum like you've got in Southampton.
It is. I mean, what is the sweet spot between giving the customer enough choice and not confusing the customer with too many unit types? And our sales director is sat here. So we look at our data a lot. You know, what's leasing and why, and where's there extra value, what's popular, what's not popular. So we've got to use that data as well to help us. Where we've also been challenged is that we've delivered development after development very quickly, so you're not learning as quickly as you would like. And either therefore you're making changes through the furniture, L-shaped sofas, king-size beds, let's squeeze it in, or you need a longer time between your developments, but that's not going to happen, because we need to deliver homes. So.
Yeah, but I think we've managed the leasing piece, so one of the things we do with our letters is really vet the customer before they come in, mm-hmm. what is important to them, so where you have such a variety of units, you know, I'm not sure if it's set, so what they really care about is two people working from home, so therefore, that limits your choice. So it's something that we manage.
Same, and actually we try to manage that more and more through tech as well, which COVID accelerated, so that actually when they arrive at the leasing hub for their experience, it can be a really meaningful tour. Otherwise we'd be there for hours with, you know, one building. So.
They're also differentiated by which way they're facing. You know, they're south facing, east facing, north facing. They're going to feel a bit different from just where the windows are, how big the windows are. So I think, I don't get it, you don't want to create just, you know, hundreds of similar boxes, but actually I think these units can be, you know, uniquely identified through furnishing, through the way they're facing. I mean, we do have three unique buildings on, you know, in our portfolio at the moment. They'll all feel different, but actually actually in terms of when I look at the interiors and the finishes, they're not wholly different.
No.
Okay, we've got carpets and you found them, and the roofs are a different shape, but they're not wholly different. And actually, customers do care in Newfoundland about the extra internal space, about 20% larger than most other units in London. And that does make a big difference. But I think walking in and saying, well, this apartment feels completely different, I'm going to take this one, not this one, that doesn't happen that often. Actually, our leasing team are taking them in and selling them the unit they want to sell them, rather than the other way around. And to Jen's point, you don't want to confuse people, because in Newfoundland, because of the shape of the building, the way it is, I think there's 16 different unit types. But you don't, if you take them to, a one-bed unit type, there's 5 choices.
Yeah.
They leave the building, they don't know which unit they want, so you've actually lost that customer. So, in a way, I think standardisation helps you. It also makes you more efficient in terms of the square foot, the rentable square foot that you're using, etc., etc. So, for me, it's if you want that, like Mark said, there's a huge BRS of stock you can go to and find completely unique properties.
Yeah, I think that's interesting, isn't it? We read stats that build to rent sectors are going to increase fivefold over the next decade. But I think, how are you meeting the challenges in terms of you are going to have more competitors around you, and you've got your own state. Mark, you're kind of in the regions, and you're kind of one of the first. But ultimately, people are going to be building around you. How do you do you see interior design as a means of retaining tenants either through brand loyalty, or how you move that long term when the new flashy development down the road gets built?
Yeah, I think we do. In terms of the locations where we are, whether it be from Newcastle to Cardiff to Southampton to Bournemouth to Milton Keynes, I think we've got some core principles about how we want to deliver that amenity space. But those are we should all be encouraging competition, I think, in the sector at the moment, because we are still a very small percentage point of the overall PI sector. And your average 25-year-old boy and girl on the street still doesn't understand what built on compared to just renting a flat in a broken block.
Mm.
So whilst that's the case, we've got plenty to go at. And you look at the number of sort of stat the other day in terms of the number of operational buildings that Manchester has compared to the number of operational buildings that Birmingham has. Manchester's got over 20, whereas Birmingham's got 7 or 8. So you can see, Manchester's not that much bigger than Birmingham. In fact, Birmingham's a big city, I think, than Manchester. So the scope of product going into those spaces, there's still plenty of room for that, and so we should not be too worried about that level of competition. We should be embracing that. We should be embracing some of the marketing that people are doing, that Vertus are doing here, that Moda are doing, the regions that we're doing ourselves, to spread that word so that people know what that's all about. In terms of amenity space, I think we've got to be true to what we core believe. It's a great building, and part of that for our case is providing, if we're talking about communal amenity space now, part of that community amenity space at ground floor, but part of that community space always at the top floor. So having a top floor space which opens onto an external terrace, even if it's quite a small internal space, only needs to be 1,000 square foot. But the wow factor that gives in terms of sound walking people being there and the types of things that can be used for, especially if it breaks out open to an external space, is amazing. And just seeing the looks on people's faces, you mark it out and they walk around those types of buildings, which most other buildings are not going to have in any location, is really cool. So you need to have those kind of fundamentals.
And I think we would be wrong not to mention ESG today. I wanted to mention it already this morning, but I think the role it has in interior design, from my perspective, is key. Larry, how do you approach that on top of all the other challenges you've got to meet, and in terms of the panel, in terms of ESG and your brand, how are you going about measuring that value that brings through to your scheme as well? So Larry, start off, how do you integrate ESG into the
first
stage? I think
the ESG need to be integrated from day one. So when we read the brief and we think about, start looking at the layout and how the spaces are going to flow between each other, and how they're going to connect, with the conflicts around the building, and how we're going to possibly bring people from the neighbourhood in and create a community, which is the social aspect, obviously. And then we need to look how the building works, and that's why what I was saying earlier, we need to look at the interiors, how it connects to the exteriors, because we bring in lighting, how we can have natural light coming in, how we illuminate the space, which obviously changes a lot in the well-being of the people using the space, how we improve the air quality of the space, how we made the building sustainable, how we reduce the use of fossil elements, or you know, we improve the sustainability of the building altogether. That's need to be done from day one. So it's layout, it's sustainability, it's looking and thinking about the well-being of the people using the space. And the people also that manage the space, they need to find, you know, they need to find a nice space to work with, and you know, need to be inclusive, you need to be a positive environment for everyone.
Roshan, I know it's a big thing for AXA, and in a way, it's your funding is tied into it. Can you explain a little bit more about how you're approaching it?
Yeah, sure. I mean, essentially, we're taking the building to what's going to be carbon neutral from what it is today. It's quite a big shift. That's obviously the E piece is, I would say it's easy, but something you throw a lot of money at and get that. But with the S piece, it's something we've been very concerned about. You know, Dolphin Square is an iconic estate. There is a huge local stakeholder based in the community around there that uses that estate. So, for instance, when we're spending money on the gym, we're going to be creating co-working space with redo the spa, the gardens, the tennis court. We are going to keep that open for the public, not just our residents. So all the local community will benefit. We'll still partner up with the local school. They can use the squash courts, etc., etc.
Great. We've got 10 minutes left. I'd like to open questions to the floor, because I'm sure with this panel you've got a few questions to ask. Anyone hands up? Left one over there.
Yes, inevitable question about windows. Maybe to Ilaria, at what point or are you discussing with your clients really what we're addressing to get off the window, where they're positioned, and what function the end uses for the residents? Are you planning that kind of stage?
Yes. Not a planning stage, but I think everything needs to be designed and taken into account as early as possible. The earlier we know how the space is going to be used, even the small things like the windows, I think is important that we get that into account, we plan for it, we make sure that all the needs are being fulfilled at the end from the smaller things. That's why we're saying I think the brief need to be very clear, and I think now we can have the experience because you know, all of us has done quite a few, you know, quite a lot of different schemes. So we know what we're going to be the problems at the end. We know what we're going to want as an end result. So the more we plan at the beginning, I think the best result we can have, definitely.
I think I'd just like to add to that point. I'm bound to say this because we're architects with in-house interior designers. But I think something like the window dressing is a key issue because you tend to have a lot going on around the window. You might have the OVHR going over the top of it, and whether you want to recess the blind box and all those sorts of things. We did that on the first scheme, 10 George Street, we did for Alistair, but now we're doing it more of an intermediate product. We're not doing that, we're making sure there's a zone for it, but not recessed, and to try to keep some of the costs down, because that's where the rental value's led. So I think, you know, we haven't discussed it here, but the one shift I've seen from an interior design perspective is some of the earlier schemes that we may be dealing with on a build to rent. We, as architects, were actually working with an external interior designer. I think in the last 3 years, every single build to rent project we've worked on, Grid Interiors have done the interiors, because I think there's an advantage of having an integrated approach, that early decision making. But that's something we haven't even covered today.
I would say I think the feedback loop on window dressings probably needs to get stronger. That would be my response to that. Rob, thanks for the question. He's dealt with some of our window challenges. About the feedback loop from teams like ours, I think, about some of the battles that we face when we actually go into selecting of window dressings. And then also from that end user, our COO, who lives in one of our developments, told me about the blind rattle, which is if you've got an open window, which, guess what, the buildings can get quite toasty because they're so well insulated. So you have your window open at night, and if you've got a blind, it flaps, it makes noise, and therefore that disturbs your good night's sleep. I mean, I think that's just genius feedback that I wouldn't know because I don't have any roller blinds in my bedroom at home. So that feedback loop needs to get stronger, I think.
A little bit of insight for us, didn't get thought about until very late on in Newfoundland. It has sort of triangular-shaped windows, and at one point they had poppers to pop your curtains onto the triangle. But, I mean, it was like a boat. We have worked around that issue, trying to save as much floor space, but we were losing 20% gain of floor space behind curtains at one point.
Any more questions? No, I'd just like to pick up on the point about, that's actually connected to window dressings, and I think, you know, but it's about windows, because
yeah.
I think the interesting, you know, there is this kind of connection between the interiors at the early stage, and it's interesting, your brief to us as architects are, you know, all windows, 1100 from the floor, because we want the flexibility and the furniture layout. That has environmental kind of benefit because you're actually maximising the daylight where it's coming in, you're not getting heat gain. So, but then obviously then it relates to the interiors, the window dressing. So I think what I suppose I'm trying to do is summarise is that it's so fundamental at the early stages to consider so much, more as much as you can about the interior design, which is what the value of interior design.
You also have the fact that if you are trying to target certain market, certain budget, you're going to have limitations in interior design. So in our first set of buildings, I wasn't at Canary Wharf at the time, but there was clearly, it was about building the best, and we've done that, but it meant, you know, no radiators, wood floors throughout, and they look wonderful. And that's great from an interior design point of view, because you've got nothing to worry about, no blockers. In the next phase, we're doing radiators on walls and smaller windows to stop the solar gain. So you then have to take into account that you're not going to get exactly the interior design you want, because you have to look at the factors that you can't control, which means you've got to part L and everything, make sure the windows are a certain size. So I think you have to consider that interior design as well. It's never going to be a perfect scenario unless you've got a bottomless bit of money that you're going to spend.
Yes.
The interior design is obviously like a really important part of delivering, you know, whatever the overall brand strategy is for the scheme. And normally that will involve, you know, it could involve brand consultants, it could involve one or more property marketing agencies. Just in terms of kind of how that input works and how that sort of overall relationship works, in your experience, what's kind of the keys to making that as successful or fluid as possible?
Sean, do you want to start? Because you're kind of going through that experience at the moment in some respects, aren't you, with more power?
Yeah. There is obviously a standard that we want to be at DSQ, but we try to pick what is best for the scheme or the individual blocks or flats. To try and tie it to a brand is not something that we're really focused on, because DSQ in itself is a brand. It's not going to be something that you then spread across the country. It is, you know, in itself one brand, one state. So we try to look at it that way.
We nearly went for a branded bed sheet at one point. This had a big black V on it, but it got vetoed by the marketing team. They said it looked horrendous. The idea was that when you walk into an empty apartment, the bed with just a mattress cover on it doesn't look that nice. And I thought, you know, sometimes you get a new car and you walk into the showroom, it's got sort of a velour cover on it with the branding on. That's what I was going for, but it completely shut down.
To get lost in translation.
Lost in translation. Yeah. We did actually have one made. But, yeah,
is that in your home?
Yeah.
I think the branding thing is a really good point to pick up, because Jenny, you, as an estate, you had that challenge, and your branding, I think, was, you know, really spot on. It really kind of, you did so many other things as well.
Thank you very much.
But you know, can you just, how's that evolved? You know, because, you know, now it is an established estate. How's that branding evolved?
Well, I mean, we've rebranded, so we've gone from TP to Quintain Living. We see that as part of our evolution and our growing up, if you like. And it's always that interesting tension, healthy tension, isn't it, between the marketing aspect and then the delivering on your promise aspect. And that's what you've got to be good at. I mean, we talked yesterday about the Instagram shot, which, linking it back to the interior design, which is really nice, but it's a moment, isn't it? It's a moment in time, it's an impression. And certainly our head of design, his mantra is that we've got to follow up on that impression and make sure that what we do is authentic. Mm-hmm. So the interior design from a wow factor, which I think we deliver on, then needs to follow up with all these thoughtful bits and pieces, like Alistair refers to with his velour V on his mattresses.
authenticity, I think, is really important around that. You can have branding consultants come in from outside and tell you what to do in a certain location with a certain building, but it's not authentic because it's not in the place, it's not grounded in either the macro or micro environment. And so one of the things that we did in Milton Keynes is to bring local artists in. So Milton Keynes is a new city, sprang up from the 70s, 80s, people who know their town planning history. And some of the artists who were there in the early days, they were in their 20s then, they're in their 70s now, they came in and did some artwork within that amenity space to add flavour, to add the authenticity. And that's great. You can involve those kind of people from the place to create what you're delivering and create the places. That's even better.
Well, that, I'm afraid, ends the session. Thank you very much, everyone, for taking part. I'm sure people might be around for a little bit later to carry on the discussions you want to. And thank you all for joining us.